Hello, chess players. Today we are reviewing a couple of viewer games. The first game that we're looking at is submitted by Break TOS from LeeChess. Don't break the TOS, children at home. He's playing the black pieces and lost his game against white. It's actually quite illustrative. Some interesting tactics and very interesting endgame ideas you will see further down the line. Just go through the first few opening lines. Queen's Gambit, Martial Defense. And yeah, here we have a big trade. And that's actually where the first interesting moment starts. And I would say this is actually where it's very important that you learn opening ideas and not necessarily opening moves. So the idea here, we have an isolated pawn for black on d5. If we have an isolated pawn, in general, the side having the isolated pawn, so black, would like to utilize its dynamic potential, meaning you want to have major pieces on the open files that are created. As you can see, there are on C and E. You might want to use the pawn as support, as a home for the knights if you can, and the bishop should shine around it. That's the general concept of it. Lots of the dynamic potential for black is lost because the queens are off the board. So from that perspective, I actually prefer white. The idea for white is also simple. You want to peter out the dynamic potential of black in this case, and you want to pile up against the isolated pawn, which cannot be defended by a pawn anymore, and then you just want to win the pawn, and with that, be a pawn up and win the game. So since the queens are off the board, what black might want to do is move the pawn whenever it can to exchange or to benefit from whatever dynamic potential has created. White, on the other hand, wants to block that. That should be the idea of the game, because this is the clear difference we have here. So let's continue with the game itself. Bishop to d3. Whilst it's not a bad move, it does follow in the concept of wanting to try to win the pawn and block the pawn itself. If you play bishop to e2 or bishop to b5, you keep the d-file open to put your rooks on and attack the pawn later. Here, black did play bishop g4, but I think knight to b4 will be very interesting, because you're threatening the bishop on d3, and the bishop needs to stay on the diagonal because of the check. And yeah, you either need to play the uncomfortable move bishop to b1, which blocks your gives you some development problems, or likely the move I would have played, king to d2, which it's not a big of a deal that your king is moved and you lose the right of castling, but black can now choose to take your bishop and play with the bishop pair, which can actually be very beneficial since you have an open board right here. So black did not do that. He played bishop to g4, and now, yeah, we have many good moves. Actually, rook to c1 would be good. Develops a rook on the open file. It's actually what you want, with tempo, so why not? You can also just castle, because after bishop takes, g takes, this is a total fine position for white. We have the bishop pair. The fact that our pawn is double doesn't hurt us so much. So it's a totally fine position. But white here played knight to e5. It's a bit of a peculiar move. I don't really see what it does. It really doesn't do anything, because you don't want to take the knight on c6. You invite black to trade, and really the bishop was not threatening anything. So in a way, you're kind of losing a move. Knight takes, bishop takes, and now rook f to e8, attacking the bishop. Not only that, do you remember the pawn on e5? Yeah, I had a bit of a story about how to play, and actually what happened, kind of nothing to do with it. So black did not really create dynamic potential until now, because you now put our rook on the e-file, as I mentioned. And white hasn't done anything to pile up against it either. So it's very interesting. The pawn is there, but it's not being played in the spirit of the pawn, so to speak. And here, black plays rook a to d8, and it's a bit sad, because you have beautiful d4. So as I mentioned before, we might want to move the pawn to exchange a pawn or utilize the dynamic potential. And here you can, actually. So after d4, we are attacking the bishop on c3. we are attacking the pawn on e3, and the pawn is pinned. So we cannot take with our bishop, because we will lose our bishop, because it's not defended, because the pawn is pinned. And after we, let's say, move the bishop to d2, the most logical move, then we have d takes e3, and after f takes e3, you can, as black, now either instantly cash in and take the pawn with bishop takes e3, bishop takes e3, rook takes e3, check, and we are up a healthy pawn. Or, even better, we first play rook a to d8, hitting the bishop, so again, developing our rook with tempo on the open d-file, and after the bishop moves, again, we just take the pawn, takes, check, and not only are we a pawn up, but we got a free move in, because we first played rook to d8. So that would be a very good way of playing. Unfortunately, black played rook a to d8. Now we continue with h3, okay? Bishop h5, g4, bishop g6, and castles. Castles is actually a good move here, defending the bishop whilst developing the rook. Now bishop e4, rook h2 e1, bishop f3, rook d2, and bishop to g2 here. Again, d4, this is actually a beautiful moment. So I think d4 is a very nice move, and you are very likely to, well, you have a good chance of winning. Because, again, we are utilizing the pin of the e3 pawn, and whilst there is an escape for white, it's actually not that easy to find. There's only one move preventing white from totally losing the game. If you look at the position, the bishop is decked. Well, it cannot take on d4. We can only move to a5, and then b6 follows, and we still lose our bishop. So the only move that does not lose here, actually a nice kind of tactic to find. If you want to pause the video and find it, I'll continue in 3, 2, 1. So bishop to e2 is the only move that saves you. And it is because you attack the bishop on f3, which is not defended. And it's actually very interesting to see. Taking directly, d takes c3 doesn't work, because rook takes, and now after check, we take, and now rook takes, and we take the bishop. That's not defended. That is the point here. So, although I have to say that it's clear that the black is playing for the win with rook to d2 check, but yeah, this clearly a drawish position. And if we are like, okay, well, let me, instead of taking instantly, and first get rid of the bishop by bishop takes, then that does not work because of this brilliant counter tactic. E takes d4, attacking both bishops. We are attacking the bishop on c5 with our pawn on d4, and the e2 bishop is attacked with both rooks and only defended once. There's no way to save them both, and therefore this is a saving move for white. Continuation would be bishop takes d4, bishop takes d4, for example. So whilst there is a save, it would be a very good move regardless, so play it, and you stand a very good chance that white doesn't find it. It's a difficult move to find. Don't play it because it's difficult to find. Play it because it's a good move, and it is. Okay, so this did not happen. Bishop g2. Bishop to f1, bishop f3, bishop e2 will actually put a couple of moves on the board. Yeah, this is an interesting moment again that I annotated. So here, it is interesting to notice that the bishop on e4 is very strong. It cuts off the king, and the king is on, yeah, an open file on c. So instead of taking instantly, you might want to consider moving your rook to c8 first. And white is in some problems and needs to be very passive and is on the defending end for a while. So you really want to keep that tension on the board and make it a bit worse. So instead, trading off instantly also dissolves the tension instantly. And here, rook takes d4, still going on the open file, which is good. Check. King d2, check, and we continue. Rook takes b2 is good. Rook 1d2, this is an understandable move. King takes d2, rook to 8, lets me put some moves again, and here we have the moment that finally the isolated pawn is attacked and pinned, so now it will fall. It has been lacking a bit in the game. I think it should be white's plan from the beginning, And where black had the opportunity, which was for sure twice in the game, black should have pushed the pawn. King to f8. Rook takes d5, and after the trade, this is an interesting moment again, and this will actually be a very interesting and illustrative endgame. So what do we have here? We have a, well, same, we have light squared bishops from both. Black has one pawn more on the queen side, white on the king side. The white king is a little bit closer to the center, and the white bishop is very central, but very important, the white pawns, three of white pawns, are on white squares. You don't want them on white squares if the bishops are on white squares, because we want to attack them and not need to defend them. So what is the next move that black plays? Of course, the pawn was attacked, so b6. And then white plays e4. It's not a good move. Whilst you might say, okay, the pawn blocks the bishop, that might be true, but black can play f6. And after that, we just reroute the bishop through g6 to e8, and then to, for example, b5. And then we have options. And depending on what the positions of the white king is, you can go to e2, to f1, attack the pawns from behind. It might be very, very annoying for white. So, in this position, we can play f6, but king to e7 is also fine, because we improve our king position, and we can still play f6 on the next move. So here, f4, and now indeed f6, again with the idea, as I just explained. King to c3, logical move. Bishop to g6, following the plan, also moving the king up one would have been good. And now h5, kicking the bishop. Interesting. Whilst I would expect here bishop to e8, unfortunately bishop to f7 is played, and this is a blunder squared. And I'm telling you why it is a blunder squared. First of all, it is a misunderstanding of the position. Regardless of any calculation of any lines, you have here as white four pawns on white squares, on light squared squares at the moment. Black has all pawns on dark squares. The bishops are on light squares, so you want to keep the bishops. If any bishop is stronger, it is the black bishop at this moment. And white needs to try to battle that to make his own bishop stronger. But for now, black does not want to trade bishops, so offering the trade is wrong. Now there's a second reason why it's wrong. It's just because it's losing. If white just takes, bishop takes, king takes, then it can simply walk in. King c4 threatens to win both pawns and then queen. So you cannot allow king b5, king to a6. Your king is too far away. So a6, king d5, same problem is there. It is game over. So that is why that is a blunder. White did not see that and played king to d4, which is still okay. It's a blunder to not take advantage of it, again, also for two reasons, because you want to get rid of your bishop, and it is a winning king and pawn endgame. But there is some logic in moving your king to a better square. Bishop e8, the good move, the correct move, but we have now lost the move by playing first bishop to f7, although we have survived the potential trade we were offering, because it would not have been good. E5, okay, bishop d7, this is a good play from white, and actually will become very interesting, because this is a quite good position white has, and I will just call this shuffling. Although black attacks a pawn here, we will see some shuffling now, and whilst you think, oh okay, well this will stop and they will agree and trot, it actually does not happen, because what happens is that here white kind of blunders by playing bishop to e4. So bishop to e4 of course allows bishop to e2, and this is why your bishop is stronger, because it can attack pawns. The white bishop can attack nothing, yours can, and well, if white does not prevent it, we just will. So attacking g4 kind of forced king f4, and now king to f6, and the king will never leave f6 unless it's beneficial. So that means that those three pawns that you have on the king side won't progress. They cannot be played. Also, because they're all on light squares, they need to be defended, especially the base on g4. Now, we have two pawns versus one pawn on the queen side, so that should be very good. White plays king d5 here. And now, the idea for black should be winning. So black's idea is it should be quite simple. Here, as I explained, nothing will happen on the king side for white, where white is the majority. So what black needs to do is push his pawns on the queen side. So push b5 now, follow up with a5, and then come with b4 if allowed, and create a passer. When you've created the passed pawn on the queen side, you draw away the black king, so that needs to go to the queen side. And then we simply are going to munch on the pawns on the king side. You cannot really prevent that, because you have two pieces that can attack the pawn, and only the bishop can defend. And if, yeah, there's no if, you will lose from that perspective. So it's easier said than done. If you want to have a bit of a show how it's done, there's even an opposite bishop endgame I have in my channel, where Magnus displays. Have a look at that. I put it in the description. But that is clearly the idea here. So bishop to b5. Does not follow that principle. And again, we will see some shuffling. And unfortunately, black does nothing. Black just moves the bishop. And well, so does white, probably content with drawing in this position. But as we keep shuffling the pieces, white decides, okay, let's move my pawn. It's still not that, that horrible. But now, bishop to b5. And again, please don't take the bishop. First of all, for understanding, you have now every single white pawn on the light square. So your bishop is better. You don't want to take it. And the second reason why you don't want to take it, which actually black did, unfortunately, is that after a takes b5, now we have a one king and pawn endgame for white. The reasoning is simple. There is a one pawn stopping both pawns on the queen side. And it's still illustrative because both sides still go a little wrong a bit. So let's see. King f7. And now king e5, which is the correct move. King e7. And now you just want to play the simplistic king to d5. Your threat is to go to c6 and then to b7, eating the pawns. And if black responds with king to d7, the most logical move, we have the winner, the pawn breaker, with g5. Black needs to take. After black takes, we do it again, f6, and after g takes f, h6, and it is game over. White will get the queen, and black can resign. So, as you can guess, it did not happen. Here, white played king e4, which is not the right move. Why not? Because if king f6, now white just needs to play king f4, and this repeats the position. Now he can still go correct and follow the moves that he did before, but we do repeat the position once now. If we do it another time, we have a draw, so you have to be very careful as white. So I said, by the way, that the king needs to go to f4. Let me show you why. That is because the race with king d5 is a draw. In general, if you have a plus pawn, which white kind of has, so the pawns are equal, but the b5 pawn stops both black pawns, so we can kind of consider white having a plus pawn. You want to prevent races and just use your extra pawn to draw the opponent away and then kill him on the other side. So king g5, let me just show you how the race ends. These are all logical moves. So here we go, racing, queen, queen, draw. So that's not something you want. So in the game, after king d6, king d4 was played though, and now it is actually very quick, king e5, and yeah, now it is just game over. So some moves were played, I'll just put them on the screen so you see them, but white now wins very, very quickly. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this game. Let's move on to the second game we have.